thank you for every one of you for coming to celebrate the life of Shirley June Sleightholm. And that's really what this is a celebration. We're not mourning as those who have no hope. It's difficult for those of us who are left behind. So there is a sense of real grief and mourning that's completely normal and natural, that is part of being human. But we also know that there's a life beyond the grave. We know where Shirley is. She's in the hands of the Lord Jesus. She's standing in his presence, and she is looking at him in all his glory. And that is an amazing, very difficult, mysterious thing for also for us to comprehend, given this is all we know. But she is not lost. She is very much alive. And so we have come here also to celebrate her life and to remember her. And you'll hear many different memories and reflections. And this is just beautiful. The images and the pictures and the things that most of all reflect her life. And we thank you also for this, the incredible service of Martin Brothers. And so just to open up this service, and please, each of you, if you have a bulletin or a program, we will be following the outline as the celebration of life that you see, starting with the welcome and prayer. And we'll commence right after I pray. And so if you just bow your heads with me and we'll pray. Father God, you reign on high. You are almighty and we worship you. We thank you, Lord. You are the giver of life. And it's incredible the things that we can face, the things that we can go through in life. But we also know that we go through life not alone. We do have an assurance, a blessed hope in Jesus our Lord, the maker of heaven and earth, who has corrected so much that needs to be corrected, who has removed the sting of death for those that place their hope in you. And so we thank you, Lord, for Shirley Sleightholm, 97 years, Lord God. And it was never too late. Shirley accepted you. She trusted in you. And now we know where she is. She is with you, Lord, face to face. And so now we have gathered. I pray that you will comfort our hearts, that you will heal and repair what needs to be healed and repaired, that you will allow us to smile at the memories, as we reflect on the events of our lives with Shirley in our life. And I just thank you, Lord God, that we can all come together. I thank you for life. It is very precious. It's something that to not be thrown away. But we also honor life, Lord, because we are created in your image and there's value, immense value. And you are a God of love and mercy and justice. And you love us, Lord God, which is why you gave your only begotten Son, Jesus. And so we thank you for this morning. We thank you for the people that will be participating and take part, the slideshow, the eulogy, the tributes, all of this, Lord God. And we also thank you for the opportunity to gather and fellowship and share all of this together in our grief and in our joy. Amen. At this time, I'd like to call Kevin Nickel to do the eulogy, the grandson of Shirley Sleightholm.
Grandma Shirley June Sleightholm of Lethbridge, Alberta, passed away peacefully into the arms of Jesus with family by her side on Wednesday, November 2nd of this year at the age of 97. Shirley was born in Moose Jaw, Saskatchewan on April 12th, 1925 to parents Addison and Anna Hagen. She was raised and educated there until moving to Vancouver, BC, where she met and married William James Sleightholm. They later moved to Lethbridge, Alberta, where she resided until her passing. Life for Shirley was full and varied. She was never afraid to take on new challenges to the amazement of her family and friends, as they recognized just how brave and determined she was in settling and accomplishing new goals. She not only was an accomplished bookkeeper, she also liked traveling, volunteering at various organizations, and growing an amazing garden and beautiful flowers each year. Her other interests included baking, doing various crafts, swimming, curling, baseball, fishing, camping, playing piano, beating me at card games, especially cribbage, and having a pet dog or cat in her home, which truly gave her a great enjoyment throughout her years. Shirley held a special love in her heart for her family, especially for her grandchildren and great-grandchildren. When Shirley moved into St. Therese Villa 5 years ago, some of her abilities to do things changed, but she graciously adapted and met new challenges with dignity and courage. Her loving, kind, funny, and feisty spirit came out even more as she grew beautifully where she was planted. 2 summers ago, Shirley asked Jesus into her life to be her savior, and although Shirley will be missed dearly by her family and friends, this parting is not without the blessed hope that Jesus gives us in the Bible, where those who are believers and followers in Jesus Christ will see each other again in heaven. Shirley is lovingly remembered by her daughter Gail, husband Harvey, Nicol of Lethbridge, and their children, Kevin, his wife Evie, Nicol, and children Micah, Levi, and Olivia, Roberta Nicol, and Deanna, her husband Peter, Fast, with her children Judah, Naomi, and Mira, and Shirley's daughter Peggy, her husband Ron, of Maple Ridge, BC, and their children, Leanne, McKittrick, Heather Livingston, with children Lindsay, Jackson, and Zandra, and Janice McKittrick, with children Abigail and Caitlin, and daughter-in-law Jean Sleightholm of Lethbridge, and her children Dallas Sleightholm, Carly Drysdale, and with her children Caitlin, Bradley, Leanna, and Matthew, daughter-in-law Lean Sleightholm of Cranbrook, BC, and her children Billy and Bunny, and numerous nieces, nephews, and family. Shirley was predeceased by her parents, Addison and Anna Hagen, sister Claire Palin, daughter Leslie Hagen, and son William Sleightholm Jr. In closing, I'd like to thank the many staff and friends at the St. Therese and St. Michael's Care Centers. Also, I want to thank my mom for her continued care and visitation of Grandma over the many years when many of us here were unable to do the same. So thank you all, and thank you.
Never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up till I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Through the fire and in darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. Oh, and all my life you have been faithful. You have been so, so good. With every breath good. God is so good. God is so good. He's so is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. You have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful.
And I know if they could talk to me now, that they'd say to me. Wish you were here, it's such a beautiful place. Wish you were here, nothing but clear sunny days. It never rains and no one complains, and we haven't seen time. Wish you were here. It never rains and no one complains, and we haven't seen a tear. Oh, we're having a great time, and we wish you.
I'm Shirley Sleightholm's daughter, Gail, and today I would like to share some thoughts I have on my mom. There are so many that continually come to my mind, so I'll try and keep it just a few. Okay, growing up as a child, I have some fond memories of some of the fun things we did together as a family. The winter treks to our favorite toboggan hill, just a few blocks away from our house. All us kids left for the hill bundled up, wearing one or two pairs of warm mittens Mom had knitted for us. Mom enjoyed knitting and kept a never-ending supply of mittens on hand, and even more on the needles to be completed. Mom usually had hot chocolate and marshmallows waiting for us when we got back from sledding, us being all soaking wet, red-faced, but happy. We also had an outside ice rink just at the playground across the street. Many a time, Mom and Dad laced our skates and we walked across the street to the rink wearing them. We definitely lived in a great location with fun activities close by. Summer held many happy memories too. Because Mom was a lifeguard in Moose Jaw as a teenager, she helped us to love swimming too. I remember the many days we spent swimming at the Lions and Henderson pools. Speaking of swimming, I remember the fun trips to Moose Jaw, Saskatchewan, to visit my mom's parents, Grandma and Grandpa Hagen. It was there we got our first swimming lessons from Mom, who tried to teach us swimming skills at the nearby beach, the same beach where Mom had lifeguarded years ago. I have to admit, I was not one of her best students, as I could not get over the fish and sometimes garter snakes sharing the lake with me. Anyways, because my dad worked on the CPR railway, we often rode the train either to Moose Jaw or back home to Lethbridge. And Mom and us kids got to snuggle together to sleep in the nighttime train berths and share peanut butter sandwiches and cookies that Grandma Hagen packed for us. Trains still hold a special place in my heart today because of those trips to Moose Jaw with Mom. Summer was also a busy time for Mom. She insisted to having a big garden, and she often spent many times there weeding and hoeing. Mom definitely had a green thumb. Outside and inside plants always thrived when they were in her care. Trips to Creston, BC was an annual summer trip to get the fruit she needed to do her canning. I remember the countless jars of canned fruit and vegetables lining the pantry shelves downstairs for the family to enjoy all winter. Looking back now as an adult, I see my mom as an amazing woman and a mother taking care of a busy household. I often wondered how this mom of mine mysteriously got so many things done in a day without today's modern appliances. I remember wash day was literally that. By the time Mom finished washing her clothes, using her old wringer washer and rinse tub, and then hanging them on the outside line to dry, and then bringing them in to be folded and put away, the day was done. I remember our family weekend fishing and camping trips to the mountains. We never stayed at the conventional campsites. Oh no, it was always some secret mountain site where there was always a river close by and the fish were plenty, and the occasional bear. Mom and Dad were good at fishing, but Mom still packed the car with lots of food and baking, just in case. Many of our camping excursions included our cousins and family friends, which added even more fun. Summer vacation was special in another meaningful way for me. Mom brought us kids to daily vacation Bible school, and it was there I was able to learn more about Jesus while enjoying red Kool-Aid and cookies at the same time. Mom also discovered the little Staffordville Baptist Church just walking distance of her home, and I was able to go to Sunday school and join the Explorers and CGIT programs. To this day, I am thankful to Mom for helping me with my early steps to growing and knowing God better. As we grew up and had families of our own, Mom enjoyed coming to family gatherings. Her favorite dish to bring was baked sweet potatoes with marshmallows on top. Matrimonial squares came in as a second close. Mom also liked to organize functions and volunteer whenever possible. And when us kids were grown and out of the house, she did even more. Working elections, organizing crib tournaments, bake, craft, and garage sales, and still keeping up her bookkeeping and income tax business was short of amazing. She still was doing her own income tax at the age of 91. I also found myself admiring my mom to having so much patience when it came to doing crafts. Her needlepoint, knitting, and difficult puzzles always were completed, and it appeared to be with such ease. She truly worked hard to finish the projects. Mom also was a wonderful piano player. Her last sheet music on her piano stand was her favorite piece, the Black Hawk Waltz. Her eyes still lit up with joy and recognition when we recently played the music piece for her in her room at St. Therese. Later, when Mom was slowing down in the yard work department, Harvey took over the weeding and the cutting of her lawn. I remember when Harvey was mowing, every now and then, Mom would walk up to Harvey and ask to push the mower a few strides, just for old time's sake. So funny to watch her. Harvey always got rewarded by Mom with an ice cold drink in hand. A few strokes, bouts of forgetfulness, and the tiring of trying to keep up started to take its toll on Mom, not only physically, but also mentally, and she eventually came to the conclusion that she will need to move into a senior's facility. She loved her home, and moving out of it was one of the most difficult decisions she has had to make. Also, she chose to give up her driver's license, another loss of her independence she had to come to terms with. When Mom did move to St. Therese in October 2017, a new way of living and life began for her. This move came with many changes and challenges. It was a time where Mom graciously learned to ask for help with things she was unable to do herself. Living in Lethbridge, I was able to spend a lot of time with Mom. Talking about how she was doing and how her day was gave me insight to her needs or concerns. I felt that we were not only a mom and daughter, we were friends as well. Mom still enjoyed playing cribbage, Scrabble, and word searches became a daily routine until she started to struggle this past year. St. Therese's recreation staff still did make it fun for her as their programs were set up for all people with all abilities. Wheelchair bike rides, Henderson Lake outings, getting her nails done, musical entertainment, Christmas light tours, and many games where she even won a chocolate bar or two. The last year, though, after having another small stroke, doing what she loved to do before became more difficult to her. Her speech was a little slurred, and she tired more easily. But she still got excited when she had a visitor, and that never changed. She always thanked them for coming. One thing for certain, Mom always kept her sweet smile and twinkling eyes whenever she met someone, and her sense of humor was funny and endearing to witness. She enjoyed her friends at her dining room table, and they and the staff liked joking with her. She always loved her coffee and ice cream. Her good friends, Don and Gwen at the hairdressers, always made my mom laugh, and the sunshine of all their laughter radiated from her face upon returning to her room. Mom truly enjoyed her friends at St. Therese, to whom she shared her life with. Terry was another friend. She's very special to Mom. She came to play weekly Scrabble, and with the both of them making up words that were not in the dictionary, the laughter was invigorating. Thanks to all of Mom's friends who brought so much joy into her life. I saw my mom growing even more gracious as she aged. She made me so proud of her. Proud of her courage and fortitude she showed as she uncomplainingly handled each life issue that came her way. It made me cry and proud at the same time to see her be so brave. Her body was getting weaker, but her love and the way she showed it grew stronger. It really touched my heart when she showed concern for me and asked how I was doing. Thoughts about herself hardly ever crossed her mind. She rarely complained. I will always treasure the fun bedtime routine we had and the laughter that came with it. Putting on her pajamas, creaming up her feet, putting on her kitty slippers to keep her ever cold feet warm, washing her face with an extra warm face cloth, and she said, felt so good. She brushed her own teeth. Then it was time to tuck her into her warm bed. This getting Mom into bed was no easy feat. It took teamwork. Both of us counting 1, 2, 3 and lifting her was an organized but hilarious ordeal in itself. Once in bed, her two favorite teddy bear friends were then tucked in beside her, and without a miss, Mom asked this question. Do you know what I could use right now? Some chocolate. We laughed and then negotiated just how many pieces to have. Her favorite was the peppermint Ariel mini chocolate bar. We then had a quiet time of prayer together, starting with what we were thankful for that day. Some days, Mom got confused and frightened more than usual. I found that after praying together, her anxious thoughts seemed to be calmed, and she was relaxed to sleep. I often pointed to her picture of Jesus, that one just over there, holding the lamb hanging on her wall to remind her that Jesus was holding her tight in his protective arms. She was that little lamb, and she was never to fear. He is right there with her, and she could talk to him anytime. She commented many times throughout the day when passing that picture that this was her favorite. That picture is on the back of the bulletin that we kept there. Anyways, the last 2 weeks of my mom's life was up and down emotionally as we struggled to get her pneumonia under control. We eventually had to move her to the hospital for a few days and then into St. Michael's Palliative Care. There, after 3 days, she passed away gently and with a peace that God's presence can only explain. The last day before her passing, God blessed us by providing Mom's strength to smile, respond, and enjoy her family and friends who came to visit and encourage her. She was mostly alert, and her twinkly eyes of recognition to those in the room was endearing to all. My mom gave her heart to Jesus 2 years ago, and I saw a change in her, a peace and acceptance that she's going to be okay, no matter what. She grew in her own way and timing to trust the Lord with her life. These last 2 weeks, I was able to go through some of Mom's clippings of poems and wise quotes she had saved throughout her life. I was very happy to see so many poems that were encouraging her that God is with her and he will be her strength when she was weak. One of the poems in a collection I found was Reflections. Mom never talked too much about God out loud, but through the evidence of all the writings she had collected and saved, I can see that she was open to hearing from him. Her favorite hymn was In the Garden, and I wondered about all the quiet times Mom spent in her garden and that perhaps she and God were having some pretty special talking time together. In closing, my mom was one of the sweetest, humorous, strong in determination, never to give up woman that I know, and I can proudly call her my mom. Oh, by the way, Mom, Harvey wanted me to mention that yes, he will still cut your lawn up in heaven for you. On a final note, the last day I got to thinking about this will be my mom's first Christmas in heaven. She now has a full and complete understanding of Jesus' love for her. I can picture Mom out of her wheelchair now, joyfully walking and talking together. For those who may not know Jesus yet, or for those who may not be who may be needing encouragement, I would like to share this poem called If You Look at, For Me at Christmas. Here's the poem. If you look for me at Christmas, you won't need a special star. I'm no longer just in Bethlehem, I'm right there where you are. You may not be aware of me amidst the celebrations. You'll have to look beyond the stores and all the decorations. But if you take a moment from your list of things to do and listen to your heart, you'll find I'm right waiting there for you. You're the one I want to be with. You're the reason that I came. And you'll find me in the stillness as I'm whispering your name. Love, Jesus. I love you, Mom, and I can hardly wait to see you again. Your daughter, Gail. And here's her sweet granddaughter to share, Carly Drysdale.
When I think of Grandma, I think of her sense of humor, her independent spirit, and her determination. But mostly, I think of her love for us, her grandchildren, and great-grandchildren. I'd like to share some loving memories I have of our wonderful grandma. I remember the countless hours she spent knitting us toques, scarves, mittens, and sweaters, wrapping them all with love for Christmas or our birthdays. Even after she developed arthritis in her hands, she continued without complaint and love in her heart. I remember her teaching us how to play crib, rummy, and many other card games, and how she almost always won. I finally beat her at crib a few years ago, and I took a picture of the crib board for proof that I actually won, one and only time. That was a very proud moment for me, but I still feel like she may have let me win that day. Only she really knows. I remember her taking my brother and I along wherever she went, whether it was shopping, volunteering, or going with her to businesses where she did the bookwork. She wanted us on our best behavior and put up with our uncontrollable giggles at times. My fondest memories are picking Saskatoons with her in Indian Battle Park and our drives together to visit my dad in Elko. She made the trip fun by always bringing chocolate bars, her old 8-track tapes, and a blanket for us so we could lay down in the back seat when we got tired. I laugh at one time when her and I were really jamming out to some old country song and she got pulled over for speeding. She was so funny, I remember her saying something funny and witty to the police officer, and me wanting to hide under the seat from embarrassment. I was probably 13, so everything embarrassed me at the time. I remember her countless hours of baking, mincemeat tarts, matrimonial bars, endless zucchini loaves, and many others, so much of which she donated to organizations for fundraising. My favorite was when she would make a simple snacking cake and let me help by using a fork to get out all of the lumps. Or when she would make Jell-O and serve it with milk on top, or her creative pancakes, adding chocolate chips or cut up hot dogs to them. She was thrifty and could make something tasty out of anything. Also, her lasagna was the best. I remember the fun I had at her house. I loved to sneak in her spare room and sit in the quietness while looking at all of her knitting yarns, old pictures, and knickknacks. I admired her old soft bristle hairbrush and handheld mirror, which always sat on top of her dresser. I loved being in her office with her while she typed up people's taxes on her typewriter, and I sat and colored. She always had coloring books, crayons, and puzzles to keep us busy. I especially loved playing with the two old metal pull toys that she had kept in her bedroom closet. I remember her fierce sense of independence. She loved to travel, wasn't afraid to drive long distances by herself, even battling the icy roads in the winter, just to come see us for Christmas. Once she slid off the road and landed upside down in a creek in the Crow's Nest Pass, having to get herself out and onto the highway for help. She really was a tough lady. A memory that will always be special to me and my kids was when she decided to take them on a city bus ride. They were all quite little, and she must have been in her late 80s. They boarded the bus, rode downtown, had lunch at the Zeller's Diner, and came home. How cool is that? She was teaching them independence that gave them confidence at a young age. I have always admired that about her. It seemed that she wasn't afraid of anything. She had it set in her mind that she was going to do or try something new, and she just did it. She always encouraged us to do the same. I remember her sense of humor and how she would literally have tears in her eyes from laughing so hard at something, often laughing at herself. She had the ability to laugh at herself and never seemed to let things get her down, a valuable life lesson. I remember her tirelessly working in her garden on hot summer days, always giving me vegetables to take home. I wish I had appreciated those vegetables more. Now that I'm an adult, I sure admire her teaching the importance of being self-sufficient and working hard in order to reap the rewards later. Her roses were also so beautiful, and I would sit on her front step watching her tend to them with patience and love. Speaking of sitting on the front step of her house has always held a special place in my heart. It was there that, as a small child, I would sit with her eating my peanut butter toast and her drinking her black coffee on the early summer morning, just chatting with her while the sun came up and the birds sang. It was there that we would watch the baseball games across the street, and I'd watch her excitement to see someone get a good hit. It was there that she and I would sit petting her beloved dog, Sandy. It was there that she would greet my kids with anticipation and candy on Halloween. And it was there that I sat alone as a child, thinking about things that kids do, feeling the love, happiness, and safety of spending time at Grandma's house. Thank you, Grandma, for all the little things that I now realize are very big things. These are what have made me and all of your grandchildren who we are today. We will forever carry a piece of you in our hearts.
Beautiful tributes. Now, I'm not a cribbage player myself, but a memory popped into my head listening to this. I remember my wife and I, Deanna, going to Grandma's house, and now I'm not familiar with cribbage, so I just kind of watch it. It's like trying to read Mandarin or something like that. But Deanna sat down to play with Grandma, and you know her intensity, and Deanna skunked her is the term, right? Twice in a row. And the look on her face was just like murder. It was amazing. She, it's just a flash of it, and then she controlled herself and accused Deanna of cheating. And so there's lots of fond memories and wonderful tributes to hear. So we are here to celebrate the life of Shirley Sleightholm, who in her 97 years was daughter, wife, mother, grandmother, great-grandmother, and now she is with her Lord and Savior, Jesus. So what is the purpose of a funeral? Certainly it is not for the benefit of the one who has died. It is for those who remain on earth. It is a time to mourn the physical separation, all the events that take place from the moment the loved one dies, the preparation, the graveside, the service, all of these are part of mourning. In fact, mourning takes place in between these events and after the service is all over. Some people mourn and grieve for years. It is a time to remember the life of the loved one. There can be many different types of memories, even regrets, but it is also a blessing when there are blessed memories, and we've heard some of them right now. For those who die in the Lord, it is a time of rejoicing that they are with the Lord face to face. Their life can be a testimony to others. It is a time to reflect on our personal lives and eventual death. Are we truly ready to die? Do we know the Lord as our personal Savior and Lord? And if we do, is it being lived for Christ for eternity? Shirley lived 97 years. This is a drop in a bucket compared to eternity. Like every human that has ever lived, Shirley certainly would have had ups and downs, challenges, difficulties, joys, laughter, tears, and things she cherished, both seen by people and unseen. And that's kind of an amazing thing. That there are things that we reveal to other people, and then there are things that we don't. We'll never find out until glory. I discovered from my mother-in-law, Gail, that Shirley became devoted in the middle of her life to a particular church. She learned the hymns and no doubt had a level of desire to know God or seek after Him. You can see God at work. But it was only until she was 95 years old that she took the most important step she could ever take, accepting Jesus. So you can see God at work. Here is the Lord's sovereignty and mercy at work. It is never too late. And He reaches out to us with the antidote to our problem. What is our problem? Sin and separation from God. And this antidote is through the free gift of salvation, through the work on the cross of Jesus and His defeat of sin through His sacrifice and resurrection unto life. So let's talk a little bit about humanity now. The truth of the matter is we humans control nothing. We like to think we do, but we don't. In fact, the Bible describes life as a vapor. Isn't that amazing? In the thousands and thousands, when you look at history, one life like that, it's here and it vanishes. That everything we build in our lives, when we reflect on someone who has lived and now died, we reflect on our own mortality. But our life is so short. And there's 8 billion people in this world. When I go, almost every single one of them won't remember me. You know, it's very, very short. It's here and then it vanishes. Psalm 90, verse 3 to 6 says, "You turn people back to dust, saying, 'Return to dust, you mortals. 1,000 years in your sight are like a day that has just gone by, or like a watch in the night. Yet you sweep people away in the sleep of death. They are like the new grass of the morning. In the morning it springs up new, but by evening it is dry and withered so quick.'" Now we humans, I'm just talking generally, we have lots of issues. We elevate ourselves. We lie to ourselves, big or small. We all do this at times. We cannot be righteous of our own strength. We fall to corruption. Many people fall to corruption. We judge. We think and do things which are impure. We think and do violence. We can be selfish and proud. We are sinners, every single one of us. Now, sure, it's not so dismal. A human is capable of goodness. People can do good things. The scripture says he has put eternity in the hearts of man. We are created in God's image. We are image bearers. We bear senses and passions from God. We want to create. We want to love. We yearn for justice. But there is an overall problem. We can experience little bits of this. But the basic issue, the fundamental problem, is we're corrupted by sin. Humanity is corrupted by sin. We are the problem. Our sin separates us from God, and it also condemns us. Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." Romans 6:23 says, "The wages of sin is death." Sin has a payment. It must be paid. And that debt is death. But this is wonderful. But, there's a great but. "But the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord." So God has made a way. He doesn't force us, for we are not drones or robots, but have a will and a mind. God beckons to us through the Holy Spirit, convicts our hearts with the light of truth, and he reveals himself through creation, through history, through his word, the Bible. And he proves himself as the antidote to that sin problem and the purpose of our lives as humans. God's ways are not humanity's ways. God is perfect in holiness, in justice, in righteousness, in mercy. Man is not. We often mess those things up. Mankind may reflect aspects of these attributes, and I've seen it, but mankind will constantly fail and fall short. We are hopeless in our sins. Life is a vapor, and then comes death. But Jesus the Messiah has broken the sting of death, and it holds no power. So listen to this. John 8:12, when Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." And Jesus is commenting here with the death of Lazarus in John 11:25. And Jesus answers Mary and Martha, and he says, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." He gives us true life. 1 John 5:11-13 says this, "And this is the testimony. God has given us eternal life, and this life is in the Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life." Paul, to the church in Thessalonica, in the 1 Thessalonians 4:13 to 18, he says this, and he's trying to comfort them because there's a problem. There's all these believers in Jesus, and they're waiting for him to return, But what about people that have died? What about fellow brothers and sisters in the faith who have died? This is the fundamental problem, and Paul's going to address this. So he says, brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. That's good news. According to the Lord's word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel and the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. These are people in grief. What happens? Are they lost? Are they gone? Will we see them again? The death and the resurrection. Paul says to the Corinthian church, for what I have received, I pass on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. He goes on to say, I declare to you, brothers and sisters, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed. In a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with the immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. So, Jesus paid the price, and his blood covers all. Will you accept him if you don't know him? Will you repent and turn your life over to him, setting your own sinful desires aside and nailing them to the cross and crying out to Jesus? It is literally that simple. The thief on the cross, he never attended a church. He wasn't even baptized. He cried out to Jesus in the moment of his death, and you will be with me in paradise. Faith, he sought. And he believed. Shirley Sleightholm cried out to Jesus, and he did exactly what he said he'd do. He washed her clean, and he sealed her in Christ, never to be lost. She is more alive right now than we can even comprehend. Her body may lie in a casket. We saw that this morning at the viewing. But it is a shell. And there was a few comments that it looks different. Something has happened. She is with the Lord. And as the scriptures say, there will come a day when the Lord will raise Shirley up, and she will be given a new glorified body to live forever with her King. This is real stuff. Like Paul says, if there was no resurrection, then what are we doing? There's no point to any of this, but there is a resurrection. The book of Jeremiah describes our hearts, every single one of us sitting in here, including mine. He describes our hearts as deceitfully wicked, and who can know it? We have problems, and the Lord comes to us. And if we are all honest with ourselves, we know this to be true. And Jesus raises the stakes, right? Even if you think in your heart that you hate someone, you've committed murder, the stakes have been raised. What are we to do? We try and climb this ladder of goodness in our lives. So many people, I'm a good person. Like I said, there is goodness in the world. I'm a good person. But we know it's impossible by our strength. We can't pull ourselves out of this. We fail constantly. Why? Which is why God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him will never perish, but have eternal life. And that love, it says the next verse, that he sent his Son into the world not to condemn it. This is good news. But what are we going to do with it? Jesus, fully God and fully man, walked among men and women 2,000 years ago in Israel and taught things that shook people to the core. It was the same people, the same issues they were dealing with then, we are dealing with today. He performed miracles. He was wrongfully accused. It says he was made to look like sin, even though he was sinless. But he laid his life down freely. He died on the cross in the most brutal form of execution known to man. It still is the top of the list. And he willingly laid that life, his life down for each one of us. And if you had been the only person who ever existed in history, he would have done it for just you. And he was buried in a tomb. But this is the big thing. He didn't just stay in the tomb. The world is full of religions where people have taught and done things, and then they die and they stay in a tomb. Jesus did not stay in a tomb. He rose from the dead and was physically seen by hundreds. He fulfilled prophecy. He was seen by hundreds. Then he ascended to the Father and sent the Holy Spirit at Pentecost and changed all of history. We even set and think about history and time with before Jesus, before Christ, and after, that middle separation. It changed history. That same Jesus is still alive. As they said, as you see him go, so shall he return. Men of Galilee, what are you doing looking up into the sky? He will return as promised and is crying out to all people of every nation and language, believe in him and be saved. So here's a couple questions. What will you do with Jesus? What will you do with yourself? We all have to be honest. What will you do with the need of a Savior? Turn to Jesus and be saved, as Shirley turned to him at the age of 95 and surrendered her life in his care and believed with all her heart. Now, if you know the Lord's Prayer, please recite it with me from Matthew 6, 9 to 13. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please pray with me. Father God, we thank you once again for the tributes, for the slideshow of life, of Shirley's life, and every single person in those photos, Lord, and the people that weren't in those photos that she just touched throughout her 97 years. I pray that you would heal hearts today, that your shalom, that your peace would surpass all understanding and work in each person's life here who is grieving, who is reflecting on Shirley's life, reflecting on their own life. You know all the hurts in our lives. You know where we're all at. You know the number of hairs on our head. You know who is sealed in Christ by your Spirit and who isn't. Lord God, your love pours forth. You are righteous and just, and your love beckons, it calls to us. Your Spirit draws us to your side and convicts the world. We need you, Lord. We can't do this by ourselves. I pray that you would lift us through this, and I thank you. In your name, amen. Now I'd like to invite Deanna Fast to come and sing a song.
If Jesus comes tomorrow to spend some time with you, would you answer? Is this on? Sorry, couldn't hear it. Would you answer all his questions or lie to hide the truth? Would you welcome him with open arms or even let him in? If Jesus comes tomorrow, what then? If Jesus calls your number, could you leave today? Are you ready to lay down your worldly goods and walk away? Would it take a month of Sundays to tell him of your sin? If Jesus comes tomorrow, what then? If the sky turns black as midnight in the middle of the day, and somehow you knew that Jesus would soon be on his way, would you have to beg forgiveness, or could you reach out and take his hand? If Jesus comes tomorrow, what then? If the sky turns black as midnight in the middle of the day, and somehow you knew that Jesus would soon be on his way, would you have to beg forgiveness, or could you reach out and take his hand? If Jesus comes tomorrow, what then? If Jesus comes tomorrow, what then?
The song that we're all going to sing together is Because He Lives. I just ask you to remain seated as we sing this together.
God sent his son. They called him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, because he lives. And then one day I'll cross a river, I'll fight life's fight no more with pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory, yeah. No, he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds a future. Life is worth the living, just because he lives.
Sing the chorus again.
Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. because he lives. All fear is gone because I know he holds a future, and life is worth the living just because he lives.
Before we conclude with a short prayer, I just wanted to mention that after the service, and we'll hand it over to Martin Brothers, Riverview Chapel, there's going to be a luncheon that will be served. And so the family greatly appreciates you participating in this and eating with us and fellowshipping and spending this time. Let's just say a quick word of prayer. Thank you, Lord, for this celebration of life, for the music, for the tributes, the eulogy, for the things that you've taught us, for the things that we experience with Shirley in our lives. And we thank you, Lord, that she is with you, and we look forward to the day when we will see her again. And so, Lord, just go before us, surround us. We thank you for each person here, Lord. Bless them and bless their families. And I pray that you would also bless this food that we are about to eat to our body's use. And we thank you for Martin Brothers Funeral Home also, for the care and the comfort that they have provided to the family in this time. And so we just pray all of these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.